हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम राम हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम हरे हरे, कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, गोविंद जय जय गोपाल जय जय राधा रमन हरि गोविंद जय जय, गोविंद जय जय गोपाल जय जय राधा रमन हरि गोविंद जय जय, गोविंद जय जय गोपाल जय जय राधा रमन हरि गोविंद जय जय, गोविंद जय जय गोपाल जय जय राधा रमन हरि गोविंद जय जय, गोविंद जय जय गोपाल जय जय राधा रमन हरि गोविंद जय जय, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे,
हरे कृष्ण महामंत्र की जय, अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय, शील प्रभुपाद की जय, हरे कृष्ण। ओके सो लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड, नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्ण प्रस्थाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी निति नामिने, नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात देश तारिणे, जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवसदी गौर भक्त वृंद, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। मुखं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंघयते गिरिं तत्कृपातमहं वन्दे परमानंद माधवं श्री चैतन्येश्वरं हरे कृष्ण। सो वी वर डिस्कसिंग द सेवेंथ चैप्टर विच इज नॉलेज ऑफ द एब्सोल्यूट एंड वी हैव कवर्ड टू सेक्शंस from that particular chapter, from this particular chapter, and the modules were divided as per the acronym. Head stands for hearing, and E stands for everywhere. You see that Krishna is everywhere, and he is there in water everywhere. So that is where we were discussing, and we will today discuss about the next module, which is accept or reject. So basically, Krishna touched upon the subject where there are four types of people who come to him, and there are four types of people who will never surrender to him. So that is what he is going to discuss. And I would like to take some help from some of you to read the purports also. So the 13th sloka of the 7th chapter, if you see,
त्रिभिर् गुणमयैर् भावैर् एभिः सर्वमिदं जगत् मोहितं नाभिजानाति मामेभ्यः परम् अव्ययम्।
कृष्णा इज सेइंग दैट डिल्यूडेड बाय द थ्री मोड्स विच इज गुडनेस पैशन एंड इग्नोरेंस द होल वर्ल्ड डज नॉट नो मी हु आई एम अबव द नोड मोड्स and inexhaustible. So he says that there are three modes, and we have fallen into this category of three modes for various reasons. And why are we fallen into this three modes? Can somebody tell why is that we are into in why we are forced to be in this particular three modes? What are the primary reasons? Anybody?
Prabhuji, one is conditioned, and we are desired to enjoy this material world.
Uh-huh.
That is why we entangle. And the another thing is even Krishna, according to our wish, with his energy, we are bound in this Maya.
Right. So based on the kind of desire you have, he will give you that kind of a body and that kind of a psychophysical nature, such that and the environment, such that you can fulfill your desires. And finally, you will be given an environment where you will always be reminded about Krishna, and you will have an opportunity to come back to him. Both he is giving. He is giving the environment and the body, such that your desire which you have wanted can be fulfilled. And also in the same circumstances, he will also put you into such a situation where if you wanted to turn back to him, and that opportunity also he is giving. So that kind of a arrangement is what is there in this material world, which you are influenced by the three modes, tamasic, rajasic and sattvic mode. So we will see that why these modes are important and how is that we can get out of these modes. How is that possible? That's what we'll see. Now, in the purport of this 13th verse, here Krishna says that there are four classes. Can somebody read the purport, please, for me? One of you?
Go ahead. Deluded by the three modes, goodness, passion, and ignorance, the whole world does not know me. Who am above the modes and inexhaustible.
Hmm.
Purport also?
Yes, ma'am.
The whole world is enchanted by the three modes of material nature. Those who are bewildered by these three modes cannot understand that transcendental to this material nature is the Supreme Lord Krishna. Every living entity under the influence of material nature has a particular type of body and a particular type of physiological and biological activities accordingly. There are four classes of men functioning in the three material modes of nature. those who are purely in the mode of goodness are called brahmanas. Those who are purely in the mode of passion are called kshatriyas. Those who are in the modes of both passion and ignorance are called vaishyas. Those who are completely in ignorance are called shudras. And those who are less than that are animals or animal life. However, these designations are not permanent. I may be either a brahmana, kshatriya, vaishya, or whatever. In any case, this life is temporary. But although life is temporary and we do not know what we are going to be in the next life, by the spell of this illusory energy, we consider ourselves in terms of this bodily conception of life, and we thus think that we are American, Indian, Russian, or Brahmana, Hindu, Muslim, etc.
Enough, Mataji. Mataji will stop there.
Thank you
so much. So it is clear that we are deluded by these modes, and deluded meaning that here Krishna also mentions that our atmika, a forgetfulness of true identity. So when you are deluded by these modes of nature, what will happen is that one thing, you will forget, you will be forgetting your true nature. What is your true nature? You are not this body, you are spirit soul. That one you will forget when you are deluded by the modes. And we see that majority of the people, I would say 99.99% of the people are deluded by these modes, and they are avaratmika. That means forgetfulness of the true identity is happening. And there is one more, what Krishna is saying, prakshekatmika. Prakshekatmika means assuming the false identity leads to false perception about myself and Krishna. So this is another the influence of the mode when you are deluded by the modes. So avaratmika, prakshekatmika. So in that case, you will not consider yourself that you are your true identity, and you will also take some other false identity, false perception about yourself and Krishna, the Supreme Lord. If somebody asks, who is Krishna? They can give whatever answers, because that is how you are deluded by the modes. So what is the result of when you are deluded by this kind of a modes is what Krishna is saying. What will happen is that when you are deluded, the result is that one forgets that the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is beyond the modes. So you will forget about Krishna, and but you will just be occupied in this particular way. So what happened is that there was one time in Bhagavatam, it is mentioned, Indra was cursed, and he was cursed to go into the Bhuloka and become a pig. Now, for a certain time, he is supposed to be taking that curse, and so he goes to the Bhuloka and he takes the form of a pig, and he is now actively involved with his family, his sheep, pigs, and his children, and he was so busy. And once the time frame of the shapa was over, then they asked to come back, Indra, to come back, he was saying that, why are you asking me to come to the Indraloka? I'm very happy here. What will happen to my family? What will happen to my wife, my sheep pigs, and all that? So we are also like that. When we, the result of this delusion is that we forget that Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is bound by the, who is beyond the modes. So Krishna, the Supreme Lord, is beyond the modes, and we forget about him. They do not understand that behind the material nature, there is Supreme Personality of Godhead. So that is the reason why a lot of people are deluded, and in the delusion, they do not understand that there is a hand behind this universe, and that is none other than Supreme Personality of Godhead. Okay. And so what is that he was talking in this purport is that means to identify oneself with a particular type of body and its type of psychophysical and biological activities, which is what is giving rise to the varna, But and you identify with your varna. That is, I am a Brahmana, I am a Kshatriya, I am a Kshudra, I am a Vaishya. This kind of identification you will do with that. As well as some people may do it with the nation, with the community, etc. So this is all because you are deluded by the modes of nature. And how modes of goodness delude? Can somebody tell me how is that the modes of goodness can also delude you? Because you wanted to come to the sattvic guna, then why? How is that? That also is a deluding to you. Anybody could throw some light? No idea. See, what happens is that when you are in the mode of goodness, it limits your understanding of the absolute to be impersonal Brahman, and that kind of a misconception can also happen when you are in the mode of goodness. Okay. So another main thing is that it conditions one by happiness and knowledge. See, when you are in the mode of goodness, you are having some knowledge, and that knowledge will also be kind of conditioning can happen, and you will be happy and you do not want to come out of it. So that kind of a conditioning can happen when you are in the mode of goodness also. That is the reason you need to overcome the mode of goodness also, that is sattvic guna, and then go beyond that. So that is what Krishna is trying to tell here. So we'll go to the next sloka, which is a very important sloka again. I would like one of you to read the purport also. Daivi hesha gunamai mama maya duratya mama eva ye prapadyante mayam etam tarantite. This divine energy of mine consisting of three modes of material nature is difficult to overcome. He's saying that it is difficult to overcome. That means we cannot overcome it. But again, he gives you the next verse. But those who have surrendered unto me can easily cross beyond it. So how do you come out of this mode? He's saying that these modes of nature are very difficult to overcome. But if you, that the only solution is that if you surrender unto me, you can cross over it. So can somebody read the purport for me? Only the purport. One of you.
Yes, Prabhu, I'll read.
Yeah, go ahead, Mahesh.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead has innumerable energies, and all these energies are divine. Although the living entities are part of his energies and are therefore divine, due to contact with material energy, their original superior power is covered. Being thus covered by material energy, one cannot possibly overcome its influence. As previously stated, both the material and spiritual natures, being emanations from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, are eternal. The living entities belong to the eternal superior nature of the Lord. But due to the contamination by the inferior nature, their illusion is also eternal. The conditioned soul is therefore called Nityabaddha, are eternally conditioned.
Okay, Mataji, we'll stop there. Thank you so much, Mataji. So here it is mentioned that we are conditioned, because we are conditioned because of, and this conditioning is also eternal, he says. Why it is eternal? Because when you come in contact with this material nature, your conditioning is happening. And since the material nature is eternal, so your conditioned nature is also eternal. Till the time you're in contact with the material nature. But once you surrender to the Supreme Lord, and you can overcome it. So that is what he is saying. And this is called Nitya Bhadda. So that's the technical word he is using. That living entity is eternally bound. And it is very difficult to overcome, since it is controlled by the Supreme Lord. See, basically these modes of nature are controlled by Durga Devi. And Durga Devi has got a Trishul. And the Trishul has got three spokes. And she keeps on giving you what? Three kinds of miseries. What are the three miseries? Anybody? So these are the three difficulties she keeps on giving you, and because of that you are bound to this material world and you cannot overcome it that easily. But Krishna says that these modes of nature are in my control. I can remove that to anybody, anytime. Now the problem with the, if you see, difficult by our own endeavor, but easy if you surrender. Understand this. We are conditioned souls. We are Nitya Baddha. No one can trace out the history of being conditioned. So when we got conditioned, we don't know the history. It might be millions of lifetimes, we don't know. But right now, we are conditioned soul and we are Nitya Baddha. So if you wanted to come out of it, on your own endeavor, it is very difficult. And it is easy if you surrender. Now, you may ask a question. What about the karma yogis, jnana yogis, ashtanga yogis? So what are they doing? And can they get liberation? Or can they go to Goloka at any point of time? So the answer to that, Krishna says at later point also, these kind of yogis, whosoever are there, they are basically, they are doing it on their own endeavor. And they are not, if you see anywhere, they are not bringing Krishna in picture, nor they are surrendering to Krishna. If they are surrendering to Krishna, that means they started their bhakti yoga. So if any of these jnana yogi or ashtanga yogi, if they can bring in some bhakti yoga or to in connection with Krishna, then there are the chances for them to get liberated and go back to their original eternal abode can be possible. So till that time, it is not possible. So here the point what we are trying to say is that we wanted to come out of this particular bondage, and for that our endeavor is not sufficient. We need to take the shelter of the bona fide guru, and once you surrender to Krishna or via the bona fide guru, you can be able to free yourself. So now that's what we have been discussing. So next, what Krishna is going to talk about is in the 7.15. Let's go to the 7.15. Okay. Here he is talking about those people who do not surrender to Krishna. And this is the 15th sloka. Namam duskritino muda prapadyante naradhama mayaya praharta jnana asuram bhava ashrita. Those miscreants who are grossly foolish, who are lowest among the mankind, whose knowledge is stolen by illusion, and who partake of the atheistic nature of demons, do not surrender unto me. So here he is saying that there are those miscreants who are grossly foolish. They are very foolish and who are the lowest among the mankind. That means you can call them as animals, but they are the lowest form of, among the mankind, and whose knowledge is stolen by illusion, and who partake of the atheistic nature of demons, do not surrender unto me. So that is what he's trying to put in here. Can somebody read the little bit of the purport here? Anybody?
I'll read, Prabhu.
Yeah, go ahead.
It is said in Bhagavad Gita that simply by surrendering oneself unto the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality, Krishna, one can surmount the stringent laws of material nature. At this point, a question arises. How is it that educated philosophers, scientists, businessmen, administrators, and all the leaders of ordinary men do not surrender to the lotus feet of Sri Krishna, the all-powerful personality of Godhead? Mukti or liberation from the laws of material nature is sought by the leaders of mankind in different ways and with great plans and perseverance for a great many years and births. But if that liberation is possible by simply surrendering unto the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, then why don't these intelligent and hardworking leaders adopt this simple method? The Gita answers this question very frankly.
Stop there. Sorry. Okay, stop there. Thank you, Mataji. So here it is kind of giving you a hint about what kind of an educational system that we are currently having. Because we are creating scientists, we are creating a lot of philosophers, etc., etc. So, see, the Vedic system versus the modern education, there is a vast difference. And there is fundamentally an approach itself is different. And how is that? It is what is explained here. See, first of all, the definition of education is what is given in our Vedas, which says that Vidya Dadati Vinayam. Vidya Dadati Vinayam means knowledge leads to humility. But if you see our modern education, more degrees you have and you get more pride. And there is something fundamentally wrong in this modern education system. You see that when you are a kid, when you go to LKG, second class, third class, till that time the kids are good. But more or less they respect their parents, they respect the teachers, respect the nation, they respect the leaders. Now slowly when he gets this education, he will turn into a person with pride and he is trying to curse it, quarrel, and he is blaspheming the nation, blaspheming the elders, blaspheming the teachers, and he has no respect at all. And the more education he is getting, more pride he is accumulating. So why? Because see, the whole process of our modern education system is not based on what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, what he has given in Sistashtakam, which is Trinadapi Sunichena, Tarovrapi Sahishna, Amanina Manadena, Kirtaniya Sadahari. So basically, when you have this humble nature, and Trinadapi Sunichena, so that kind of a humble nature when you have, and when you chant in that humble nature, then you can be able to really see that the holy name and supreme lord are non-different, and you can really go back to Gololoka with just by chanting the holy name. But again, for the kind of situation we are in, just by chanting the holy name is not sufficient. What I mean to say is that not sufficient meaning that in the association to chant in that kind of a mood of Trinadapi Sunichena, that means with that humble nature, you need to have the right kind of a knowledge. And that's what Krishna is supplying you, that kind of a knowledge, where you can now, once you get that knowledge, you can go into that, you will be able to experience that humility because you are getting the knowledge, the vidya you are getting. And this vidya, vidya dadati vinayam, so you will be able to get that humility by gaining that knowledge. And when you gain that knowledge, with that knowledge, when you chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, that humility, then you will be able to see that there is a significant change in your consciousness. And that consciousness, when you dovetail it and surrender to Krishna with that mood, that is where these modes of nature's influence will be stopped, or it will be cut off by Krishna himself. So, in a nutshell, what is happening is that this particular mind and Maya is influencing, and so if you wanted to come out of it, you need to surrender to Krishna. And the surrendering to Krishna starts with what? If you wanted to surrender to Krishna, what you need to do? How is it possible?
Hearing and chanting.
First it starts with hearing. Whatever, hearing what? Movie songs?
No, Lord Krishna.
Anything associated with Krishna, Krishna's forms, Krishna's names, anything associated with Krishna, when you start hearing, that is where in our first sloka, it is mentioned, Tat Shrunu. So it all starts with Shrunu, so hearing. So once you start hearing about Krishna, then things would fall into place. Okay, so... Now, here in the purport, can somebody read the purport where it says the mudas, the first one? Did you come to that? In my book, it is 364. The mudas are those who are grossly foolish. Can you read that four lines? Anybody? The next page itself. The anybody got it? Can unmute it.
See, yes,
the
Prabhu.
Sitaram Prabhu. Go ahead.
The mudas are the are those who are grossly foolish, like hardworking beasts of burden. They want to enjoy the fruits of their labor by themselves, so do not want to part with them for the Supreme. The typical example of the beast of burden is the ass. This humble beast is made to work very hard by his master. The ass does not really know for whom he works so hard day and night. He remains satisfied by filling his stomach with a bundle of grass, sleeping for a while under the fear of being beaten by his master, and satisfying his sex appetite at the risk of being repeatedly kicked by the opposite party.
So, Prabhuji, it's good, Prabhu. So basically, the first category of people who do not surrender to Krishna is these mudas. And this, most of the people come under this category of mudas. That's what in one of the lectures, Srila Prabhupada says. And we are like asses. Ass means here donkey. So the donkey knows that it will get that that little bit of grass anywhere if it goes outside and eats, it will get that grass. But again, it is serving this master in fear all the time. So that is what we are also doing in this material world. So we are also like, so that is the kind of a person who will not surrender. And these are the first category of people who are called mudas. Okay, so the second category people, can somebody read the second category? Another class of duskruti or miscreants are called naradhama. Can somebody read that? Then next, third, from there, the third, next, but the next prayer.
Yeah, another class of duskruti or miscreant is called the naradhama or the lowest of mankind. Nara means human being and adhama means the lowest. Out of 84 lakhs different species of living beings, there are 4 lakh human species. Out of these, there are numerous lower forms of human life that are mostly uncivilized. The civilized human beings are those who have regulative principles of social, political and religious life. Those who are socially and politically developed but who have no religious principles must be considered naradhamas. Nor is the religion without God religion, because the purpose of following religion principle is to know the supreme truth and man's relation with him. In the Gita, the personality of Godhead clearly states that there is no authority above him and that he is the supreme truth, the civilized form of human life.
I'll stop there, Prabhu. Thank you. So basically, the second category of people are called naradhamas, the lowest of the mankind. So here, those who are socially and politically developed. So they are socially and politically developed, but who have no religious principles must be considered naradhamas. So these are the second category of people. And that's what it is mentioned here. And what is revealed here is that so these kind of people, so the naradhamas, who is condemned by the personality of Godhead, can again revive his spiritual consciousness only by the mercy of the devotees. So if you, in the end of this particular purport, as the second category of people, here it is Srila Prabhupada provides that if there is a mercy of the devotees, these people's spiritual consciousness can be revived. Revived. Basically, we have forgotten. So, revival is possible for these kind of people is what he is talking about, especially the naradhamas. Okay. And here the example was given about Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in propagating the Bhagavad Dharma or the activities of the devotees. He recommended the people submissively hear the message of personality of Godhead. And we have also seen that the people who are like who are those two miscreants, Chaitanya Nityananda Prabhu has shown mercy.
Who are those? Jagai Madhai.
So Jagai Madhai were like this only. They were non-religious, and finally, just by the mercy of the devotee, Nityananda Prabhu's mercy, they were their original spiritual consciousness was revived. So that is the one. Can somebody read the third category, the next class of the third one in the purport? Anybody, please.
Prabhuji, I will read.
Yeah, go ahead, Venkat Prabhu.
The next class of Duskriti is called Maya Partha Jnana, or those person whose erudite knowledge has been nullified by the influence of illusionary material energy. They are mostly very learned fellows, great philosophers, poets, literati, scientists, etc. But the illusionary energy misguides them, and therefore they disobey the Supreme Lord.
Okay, Prabhu. We'll stop there. Thank you, Prabhu. So these are the next category of people. Duskrutis is called. The examples given is the great philosophers, poets, literates, and scientists. But the illusory energy misguides them. So because of that, they feel that, like if you say Einstein, Einstein was a believer in God, but in general, I'm talking about big scientists. Material illusory energy misguides them, and they think that there is nothing beyond, and their whole life, they just be in that, and they don't come out of it. So the last category, can somebody read the fourth category? The last of the Duskriti is called?
The last class of Duskriti is called Asuram Bhavam Ashritha, or those of demonic principles. This class is openly atheistic. Some of them argue that the Supreme Lord can never descend upon this material world, but they are unable to give any tangible reasons as to why not. There are others who make him subordinate to the impersonal features, although the opposite is declared in the Gita. Envious of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the atheistics will present a number of illicit incarnations manufactured in the factory of his brain. Such person, whose very principle of life is to decry the personality of Godhead, cannot surrender unto the lotus spirit of Sri Krishna.
Okay, Mataji, we'll stop there. Thank you. So in summary, here Krishna is saying that therefore, one, the first one, grossly foolish persons. The second one, the lowest of the mankind. The third one is the deluded speculators. And the fourth one, the professed atheists. As above mentioned, never surrender unto the lotus feet of the personality of Godhead, in spite of all the scriptural and authoritative advices. So, what we are trying to say is that unnecessarily, when you are doing your preaching also, unnecessarily don't break your head with these kind of people. Because it takes a lot of your energy to really see. Sometimes what happens is that in the enthusiasm, when you are learned few things, you go and discuss these things with others. And there are these kind of four people who will never surrender to Krishna. And it is very difficult for them to surrender to Krishna, because their modes of nature are influencing them that, and their psychophysical nature is such that they do not want it to, and they will not surrender. If they wanted to get surrendered, you know, people not like us, people like Nityananda Prabhu or from Srila Prabhupada, those kind of elevated souls only can influence them. So what I'm trying to say is that unnecessarily don't waste your time whenever you feel enthusiastic to preach or to tell something that you learned. So better you discuss, you have the association of the devotees and discuss there. That way it will be helpful for your progress. If not, you will also get deluded sometimes. So that is what is recommended. Okay, so next, let's go with the next sloka. Okay. And this Asuram Bhavam Ashrita, so these kind of a category of people, so they are envious towards God, and they are atheistic demons. So that is what we need to understand. So the
Prabhuji, next is one question I have.
Go ahead.
So only the last category, the Asuram Bhavam Ashrita people, in that category is only atheist, or all the four are atheist?
See, okay, you have a right question, Prabhu. But here, there are people who might really consider that there is Supreme Lord, but again, they are not putting any endeavor at all. So that kind of a, because they are so busy. So see, a donkey, a person who is working so hard, like take the example of grossly foolish, like hardworking asses. There are so many people who are working in IT. Day in, day out, almost when they go to office for 10 hours, they work there. They come back to home. Here also, they are working for 5 to 6 hours. Hardly they have time to eat also. So these are grossly foolish people. These are called mudas. If you tell them about Krishna and the Supreme Personality of Godhead, they may not deny the existence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But again, they are mudas. That means they are foolishly occupying themselves and putting all their energy into an area where anybody can really, you need what, finally, what do you need? You need the you need to have enough money to take care of your basic needs. But these people are making their life and soul to work only. So like asses. So if they know also about the Supreme Lord, they are not putting any endeavor. So there is no use. That means they are not utilizing the God-given talent or God-given ability to know about the God. All these category of people are like that. And these Asuram Bhavam, these kind of people are envious towards God, and they are atheist by nature also. That means they don't really believe the existence of God. If they believe also, they are envious about the Supreme Lord. And that is the reason why they, if you see all these Asuras, whether it is Ravana, if it is any of these other Hiranyakashipu, all these demons are envious about God. And that is the reason why Krishna is saying Asuram. Asuram Bhava Ashrita. That means they have taken the ashray of Asura. Asura Bhava. So that is what they are envious about God, and they are atheists. See, when you are envious about God, obviously you are also atheist in one way. Because if you know the Supreme Personality of Godhead to be and you know who you are, then you will not be envious. You will surrender to Him. But if they are not surrendering, that means that they are envious and they are atheists. Hope I have answered that question, Prabhu. Venkat Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Mataji.
Yes, Prabhu.
What shall the IT people do? That is also, I have a question. Because they are working like asses, correct? But what can they do for the family? They have to work now. But what is the remedy for that? The work is there. That's why they are doing like that. My daughter and son-in-law also.
The problem is that somebody has to educate them. See what they feel. And unfortunately, the kind of a slogans that they are used to is work is worship. Work is worship is a very famous sloka, famous quotation that all these mudas have. But nowhere in Shastra it is mentioned that work is worship. Nowhere. Work is work. Worship is worship. Worship means you are worshipping the Supreme Lord. So work is not worship. But they don't understand that. These are the things that are being manufactured by these people, such that they can make you work like a donkey.
Yes.
So that is what anybody, they have to realize that, and they have to come. You cannot do anything. At the most, what you can give is that ask them to attend some classes, and if their intelligence is good enough, if it is misdirected, now they can get directed properly. So that is what one can do.
Yeah.
Nothing we can do. Yeah. Any other question anybody has?
Yeah, Prabhuji, I have exactly opposite direction question.
Go ahead.
Actually, sometimes I felt so disgraced because of my swadhyaya and my daughter have pushed so much. I mean, I know, I have learned how to be balanced, but still. And then I hear Narada's story, where he serves some sadhu, and then he also does not cause him pain when his mother, his dearest mother, passes up. He takes it as a signal that he should travel towards the God. Mm-hmm. So, so basically, I'm nowhere. Actually, I would rather, as I'm been indulging myself, educating my doctor.
What is the question, Prabhu?
My personal thing. Yeah, yeah. It's not. It looks very tough suddenly for me. That's what I'm saying.
So, your question is why Narada, when her mother has expired or she left her material body, he thought that. He took that as a sign that now Krishna wanted me to surrender fully. Now there is no more baggage for me.
For me, the thing is, I'm a married man. When I'm married, I did not know that it is such a lot of mounting responsibilities would be there.
The point is that
so responsibilities are so heavy on my mind. That's what I'm saying.
No, so point is that Prabhu, see. His mother was dear to him, and she was a very pious lady, and she served the Vaishnavas so well that seva bhav has come to Narada because of her mother only. But once her mother, I don't know how her mother died, maybe because of snake bite or something, but again she dies. Then since she already left her body, there are two choices for him. One choice is that you keep on lamenting about what has happened and curse the Lord, you have taken away my mother. So that is one way. But if you understand that Supreme Lord is the controller and he is the proprietor, and he, whatever changes, whatever things can happen, without his permission, nothing can happen. So in that plan, he understood that Krishna is the planner. And he has planned such that her mother has to leave her body. And was for him to surrender to the Supreme Lord, this was stopping. So he has taken out that. And now he is fully surrendered, and Narada became who Narada is now, which we all, and he has become a guru for so many of the devotees. So you name Bhagavatam, you'll see that he is the guru for so many. Vedavyasa, he was the guru. Dhruva, Prahalad. So you name any of these devotees, he is the guru. So what more you want? So see, you need to take in anything you take in connection with, see what, I'll tell you what. See, most of us come into a position where we face problems. And it is told that in our shastras also, when the problem comes in your life, instead of pondering how big is the problem, you can also take another route. You can say to the problem that how big is Krishna? So you can tell the problem how big is Krishna instead of telling Krishna that how big the problem is. You got the point? See, I got a problem and I'm telling it to Krishna. Krishna, I have such a big problem. That is also okay. But instead of that, you tell the problem, Krishna is great. He is the proprietor. I am depending upon him. So when you tell the problem how Krishna is so great, that problem will no more be a problem. So this is the better way to look at things. In our life also, when we come across problems, instead of telling, this problem is the biggest, toughest, and I don't know how to tackle this, and you are telling the problem and you are increasing the problem magnitude. Instead of that, tell that Krishna is so great. You're telling to whom? You're telling to that problem. That Krishna is so great. So when you tell that, these things will get removed. And see, for the devotees or the people, and that is what Krishna is going to tell in the next sloka, who are the four people who surrender to him, and what is that he is going to do to the surrender source. We'll see that 16th sloka. Okay. Got struck actually. चतुर्विधा भजन्ते माम् जनाः सुकृतिनो अर्जुन आर्तो जिज्ञासुर अर्थार्थी ज्ञानी च भरतर शर्बा वो बेस्ट अमंग द भरतास फोर काइंड ऑफ पायस मेन बिगिन टू रेंडर डिवोशनल सर्विस अनटू मी द फर्स्ट वन द डिस्ट्रेस्ड द डिजायरर ऑफ वेल्थ द इंक्विजिटिव एंड ही हु इज सर्चिंग फॉर नॉलेज ऑफ द एब्सोल्यूट दीज आर द फोर काइंड्स ऑफ men who surrender to Krishna. Can somebody read this? This is a very, very important purport. And the sloka is also very important. Can one of you, those who have not read, can you take the turn to read this, please? Yeah, anybody?
Is it shared?
No, Prabhu, you should have the book with you. I wanted, because I have not been... able to communicate that we have to read the books. At least you start reading at least now in this particular way. So if you do not have, somebody can take the turn.
Bhavi Prabhu, you can go ahead, Prabhu. Bhavi Prabhu raised his hand.
Yes, yes. Go ahead.
Prabhuji, can you just tell me the which one I need to read it?
16th sloka, Prabhu. The purport for the 16th sloka, 7.16.
7.16. Okay, yeah. Prabhuji, 1 minute.
Yeah. I'll read the sloka one more time. Chaturvidha bhajante maam jana sukritino arjuna artho jignasur arthadi gnani cha bharadarshaba.
So you want me to read the purport, Prabhuji?
Yeah, I can read the translation also once and then go to the purport one more time.
Okay. Oh, best among the Bharatas, four kinds of pious men begin to render devotional service unto me. The distressed, the desirer of wealth, the inquisitive, and who is searching for knowledge of the absolute.
Okay.
Purport. Unlike the miscreant, these are adherents of the regulative principle of the scripture, and they are called Sukritna, or those who obey the rules and regulation of scriptures, the moral and social laws, and are more or less devoted to the Supreme Lord. Out of this, there are four classes of men, those who are sometimes distressed, those who are in need of money, those who are sometimes inquisitive, and those who are sometimes searching after knowledge of the absolute truth. These persons come to the Supreme Lord for devotional service under different conditions. These are not pure devotees because they have some aspiration to fulfill in exchange for devotional service. Pure devotional service is without aspiration and without desire for material profit. The Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu defines pure devotion thus: Anya Abhilashita Sunyam Jnana Karmadi Anvartam Anukulyana Krishnano Shilam Bhaktir Uttama. One should render the transcendental loving service to the Supreme Lord Krishna favorably and without desire for material profit or gain through fruitive activities or philosophical speculation. That is called pure devotional service. When these four kind of persons come to the Supreme Lord for devotional service and are completely purified by the association of a pure devotee, they also become pure devotees as far as the miscreants are concerned. For them, devotional service is very difficult because their lives are selfish, irregular, and without spiritual goals. But even some of them, by chance, when they come in contact with a pure devotee, also become pure devotees.
Prabhuji will stop. Thank you, Prabhu. So here Krishna is clearly mentioning that there are four types of people who are basically those who are distressed, and those who are inquisitive, and those who have some material desires, and the last one is that gnanis, and who are looking for knowledge, they come to me. And he is also saying that these people are not pure devotees, and he says that who are the pure devotees, and but he says that those pure devotees are without aspiration and without desire for material profit, but these people do have something. But now Krishna says that these are the people who can get my mercy also. Why? Because what happens is that when these people come in contact with some pure devotees, they will get the taste of Krishna and the taste of Krishna consciousness, and they will eventually become pure devotees. So it is not like the Krishna is saying that you should not have material desires, and he's welcoming all the different kinds of people, but he's also giving hope for the miscreants or those who are deluded by illusory energy of Krishna, that is Maya. And what is the hope he is giving? Can somebody tell me? What did we see here? What is the hope for the other four category of people who will not surrender to Krishna? What is
they come, if they come into contact with the pure devotees,
they can become pure devotees.
They can become a devotees.
By chance. So that, but it is very difficult for them, but there is a chance for them also. So that is what is mentioned here. And it is also mentioned that Vasudeva Sarvamiti Sa Mahatma Sudurlabha. So what it is mentioned is that it is not easy come in contact, but if you can pursue and do your endeavor, then you can really attain it. It's not this particular Krishna consciousness process is not that easy at the same time. It is going to take some time for you to get established and to see your final results. If you are looking for a very quick outcome, then that is one of the reasons why people turn to demigods. That's what Krishna is going to talk about that in the next verses, that why people go to demigods. Okay.
Prabhuji, can I ask? Sorry.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Actually, in the beginning itself, it seems Krishna is telling that out of thousands, one may get into the path of trying to know me. And then out of that one also, among the thousands, on so many thousands, somebody may think about me in try to investigate me. And nobody will actually, he is literally telling that nobody at all can know me in reality. Literally. That's what.
What's your question,
Prabhu? My question is, then if nobody can know him in totality, means then nobody can really, it is like an infinite, I mean, you're trying to, how much ever perfection.
No, what you're saying is that unless and until I understand the Krishna completely, I cannot go to Goloka. Is that what you're saying?
It seems so, and again, there are few other devotees who might be telling that if it's all Krishna's grace, if you realize, then you will go to Goloka. It looks both Sulabha and Durlabha.
Let me tell you, Prabhu. See, the point is that the process is simple, but we are not ready to take that process. See, I will tell you what. Srila Prabhupada once a journalist came to Srila Prabhupada and said that your process, you are saying it is very simple. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So I said Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Now, will I be able to go to Goloka now? So then Srila Prabhupada said, he gave an example. See, I have taken a ticket to go to Montreal. No, he has taken a ticket. This conversation is happening in the airport. He has shown the ticket saying that I have taken a ticket to Montreal. So now I have taken a ticket to Montreal doesn't mean that I am in Montreal. So if I have to go to Montreal, I have to first take the ticket. And take the flight, and after 5-6 hours, I'll be landing in Montreal. So this Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, the process which is there, when you follow, it will take some time. And in that process, not based on your endeavor, but because of the mercy of Krishna and the Guru, you will get the required knowledge about Krishna. And then that knowledge coupled with your endeavor, and determination. That's what Krishna is going to talk about, determination. So once you have the determination and you pursue your whatever process which is given with determination, and then you will reach, you will get the required knowledge, and also you will be able to go to the your final destination. That's what he's saying.
So I'm a bit pessimistic. I'm a bit pessimistic. So next birth is a risk. I'll forget anything.
So Prabhu, for you, for all of us, for people like all of us, what you are also thinking, Krishna is assuring you. And in the previous slokas, if you have seen, Krishna has assured you that whatever endeavor you are doing in terms of your spiritual endeavor of taking the association of the devotees, etc., etc., he is saying that this will not go waste. If you have only gained 5% in this lifetime, you will start with 5% plus from the next life. So that 5% benefit, Krishna is going to give you the right kind of a body, right kind of a environment, such that you can continue from there. So nothing is going to go waste. It is an optimistic way. If you see the entire Bhagavatam, if you read, it is the entire Bhagavatam stories is all filled with what? Positive outcome. And it is all filled with positiveness. You take any of the case studies. You see, Bhagavatam is a case study of various devotees who have gone through difficulties in their life, where they have undergone tremendous atrocities that have been, and they have undergone, and by others. And finally, the end result is that they finally went to Goloka. You said, you take any of the case studies, the final destination they have reached. You take any case study for that matter. You take Prahlad, Dhruva, any case studies, that is what it is. So optimism is there in our philosophy. It is not a pessimistic way that you cannot understand Krishna, so let me not try at all. So Krishna is saying that it is difficult. But again, if his mercy is there, you can cross over. See, that's what, when I start taking these classes, there is one, sloka that I recite most all the time. Mukam karoti vachalam, pangum langahate grim, tat krupa tamham vande, paramananda madhavam. So basically, if Guru and Krishna's mercy is there, what a person can do? A person who is dumb can speak. A person who is lame can cross mountains and he can cross oceans. So that is what he is talking about. So this is the problem with our material education, because we are all trying to compare with the material education, which is depending upon our endeavor. But here is the endeavor is there, but we are more depending upon the mercy of the Supreme Lord. And that is what we are supposed to always ask for. And once you get that, then you see, by experience, you will be experiencing little by little. It will not come all of a sudden. I've also experienced little bit that mercy is required. And once you seek that for that mercy, that is where your education has started. And till that time, you are not seeking for that mercy and you are depending upon your own endeavor. That means we are in the other path, which is what? The Karma Yogi path, the Jnana Yogi, the Ashtanga Yogi, that path, not in the Bhakti path. Bhakti path starts when you consider and you ask for mercy of your senior Vaishnavas, ask for mercy of Krishna, ask mercy from your Guru Maharaj. That is where your Bhakti has started. If you are not able to surrender, see, that is the reason. When you go to the temple, you first surrender to the Sashtanga Namaskar you do, not mechanically. But when you do that, you are asking for what? You are asking for mercy. Right? But again, there are four kinds of people who come to Krishna. That's what he is going to discuss here. We'll discuss that more, Prabhu. Okay. I know we are supposed to do this food for the soul. Let me just complete this few more slokas and then... because I've been pending for quite some time. Yeah, any other question?
Prabhuji, small that four type of persons. First one is sometimes distressed. Yes, I understood. Those who are in need of money, yes, that is also very simple. But what about these two categories? Those who are sometimes inquisitive and those who are sometimes searching after knowledge of absolute truth.
We will discuss that. Krishna is going to discuss more in detail.
Okay.
So, yes, we are there, Prabhu. We are not yet completed this particular section. So, we are going to do that. Okay. So here in the next sloka, I'm just reading the translation for that, 17th sloka. Of those, the one who is in full knowledge and who is always engaged in pure devotional service is the best. For I am very dear to him and he is dear to me. So that is what he's trying to tell here. The knowledge seekers are the best. Out of these four category of people, Krishna is again qualifying. Why he is qualifying? Of those, the one who is in full knowledge and who is always engaged in pure devotional service is the best. The Jnani part here, okay, you need to understand that. This Jnani is not the Jnani that we talked about, the Karma Yogi, Jnana Yogi, not that. Here, who is searching for knowledge, he is talking about that. Jnani means not the Jnana Yogi. This is the person who is searching for knowledge is the best. Why Krishna is saying that he is the best? Why not he is saying the others are not the best? The others are what? Distressed, inquisitive, and material desire. The last one is a jnani or a person who is looking for knowledge. Why he is saying that he is the best?
Prabhuji, the above three were not in the right knowledge, Prabhuji. They don't have knowledge. So there is difficulty in reaching Krishna. So whereas the fourth one, they having knowledge, they can able to reach Krishna with that knowledge and do devotional service with that jnana.
Okay, that is close to my answer. Any other
distress? I take the cue of distress. Distress itself, word means that something is problem with your feeling and emotion. Your perspective of it, probably. Okay. The distress means I want to reach Krishna or I want to get rid of the birth and life. You are not able to face the world. You want to escape out of this.
Maybe. Got it, Prabhu. So, any other one last input? Why is that Krishna is saying the jnanis or the person who is looking for knowledge is the best?
Prabhu, shall I try?
Yeah, go ahead, Prabhu. Gordon, Prabhu.
With your own example, Prabhu, like you have given example of father and children. If children are asking for material desires and coming to father without any love, the father don't like it. Even though he will like all the children, but who is personally liking the father, he likes him more.
Okay. Very nice. Good, Prabhu. That's a very good valid point. Now, I'll tell you what. In my own practical experience, I have seen that I've been as Govardhan Prabhu also keeps calling few devotees for Gita Subodhini who have been participating. I called a few. And earlier, I asked them, why are you not attending the classes these days? Then they said, no, I do not have any problems now. I was surprised. Why is that you are saying? What is the connection between attending the classes? I do not have problems. So these people, those who are distressed people, they come to Krishna, seek some relief from their distress. After that, they leave bhakti. Similarly, if you take the other category of people, suppose they are looking for some wealth. They are looking for some material wealth in their life. And once you get it, when Krishna gives them, they forget. So the same thing with the third category. What is the third category? Inquisitive. Inquisitive category is basically like casual inquiry. It is like there is a board, signboard somewhere saying that this is what you are going to get in this shop. But you are not clear about it. What is getting sold there? So you go and inquire, what is that you are going to sell here? And you inquire it and then leave. So all the three category, first three category of people, they inquire or they once they get the relief, whatever they got, they are looking for, they get it, they leave bhakti. And that is the reason in Gita Subodhini also, you see that a lot of people initially joined. After a certain time, they see that, okay, some inquisitiveness was there, I got to know something, then let me leave. So, but the last category of people, once they get the knowledge, what knowledge they will get? They will get the knowledge that who is the Supreme Lord? Who am I? What is the connection between me and the Supreme Lord? Then the next follow-up thing is that how do I really fulfill my ultimate goal in my life? What is my ultimate? Because this is knowledge. My ultimate goal is to go back to Goloka and I need to come out of this Janma Mrityu Jara Vyadi. So once that knowledge is the basis for which they can continue to become devotees and they will continue to do it till they go back to Goloka. So that is the reason why Krishna is saying that these, the last category of people, the gnanis, gnanis meaning again, not the gnana yogis. Please remember that. Okay. And again, here gnanis, you can also tell that they are gnanis. That means they have knowledge. But again, the percentage of knowledge versus bhakti, if you see, the bhakti is dominating in their case. This kind of category people can retain and they will achieve their final spiritual goals. Is that clear, Prabhuji's, Mataji's? Or any other question you have? Good?
Prabhuji, I have a doubt, Prabhuji.
Go ahead, Mataji.
Prabhuji, only with the knowledge one can attain bhakti, or first, sometimes the person who attracted to bhakti, or maybe some of the sankirtana process or hearing, whatever, then again they want to know about the truth. I mean, the order follows like this: first is absolute truth or learning something about knowledge of Krishna, then they go to devotional service, or first they take the devotional service by different process or through different path, then they'll seek the knowledge, Prabhuji.
So basically, whatever you need, this one here we have read that, right? What is pure devotional devotion? It says that one should render transcendental loving service to the Supreme Lord, Lord Krishna, favorably and without desire for material profit or gain through fruitive activities or philosophical speculations. Now, this is called a pure devotional service. So here it is clearly mentioning that you are doing any activity. See, you might have come with whatever intention initially, but once you get the right kind of knowledge, now you are able to understand that whatever you need to do, you will be doing it to the Supreme Lord as a devotional service. And without any fruitive results, you are not expecting any fruitive results. That means you are doing it for the sake of Krishna. Now, I'll give you the example. Suppose I am trying to give these classes, the Gita Subodhini classes. If suppose I tell that, or I have the intention that when I give these classes, I will be able to tell others that I am a good speaker. And I can get some boosting from my back saying that, hey, you are a good speaker, man. You can sing so nicely. You can speak so nicely. If that is what is my expectation, then this is not what I got the right kind of a knowledge. The right kind of a knowledge is that I am doing this service such that I can purify myself. Yes, in that process, I can understand Krishna. And in that process, others, I can get the association of other devotees, like-minded association of other senior Vaishnavas, and I will be able to hear about Krishna. So I am dovetailing all that with Krishna without any self-interest. And that is what is pure knowledge. And that is where we need to go. And if you are doing any activity with this kind of a mindset, whether you're doing this first, that first, doesn't matter. Only thing is that, are you doing it for your satisfaction or for Krishna's satisfaction? Am I seeking any material motive in this activity, or I am doing it for the sake of Krishna? Without any selfish motive, am I doing it or not? Initially, you might have got some material desires, But that also is what Krishna speaks in the end. He calls them as Mishra Bhakti. He talks about that. In the end, he talks about a special category of people who are called Mishra Bhaktas. Yoga Mishra Bhakta. Yoga Mishra Bhakta is what the category he talks about, because some of us or most of us come under that category. So we'll see about that. Does it address your question, Malati Mataji? Or no?
Prabhuji, for example, the devotees who first take bhakti, then gets knowledge, or first they get knowledge, then takes bhakti.
That is what your question was. Mataji, yes. Very nice question, actually. See, you got the knowledge. And once you get the knowledge, you can say in terms of category wise, Jnani and Bhakta, right? Jnani, Jnana Yogi and Bhakti Yogi. So now, who is dominating is what, if you see, that is where your result should be. If you are just getting Jnana, knowledge, and your Bhakti process has not started, or that is not dominating on the Jnana, then you're not really going to your destination. What should happen eventually is that we are getting knowledge, we are getting knowledge. And slowly, 1% we got a bhakti. Slowly, now this particular percentage wise, how it should transform is that your knowledge is 40%, your bhakti is 60%. And at later point of time, what will happen is that bhakti yoga has got all the other yogas inside it. You understand the point? So slowly what will happen is that this percentage of bhakti yoga in you will increase. And doesn't mean that your jnana or this knowledge will decrease. But bhakti, see, this is the difference. The difference is that your bhakti is increasing, but at the same time, you are getting the knowledge also along with the bhakti there. That's the embedded, because in bhakti, knowledge is also embedded. But from a perspective of not getting connected with Krishna knowledge versus when you connected with Krishna and you are endeavoring your activities towards achieving your final goal, that is where you are trying to progress. I know I have not yet addressed in a nice way, but we'll just park it for now, Mataji. And slowly when you read the rest of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is going to reveal it in a better way.
Because no, Prabhuji, now I got it.
Even Hanuman is a good example. Even he had to take knowledge all along before meeting Ram.
Okay, Prabhu. Thank you, Prabhu. So next, we will see that in our Bhagavatam also, these are different kind category of people, the distressed people who came to Krishna. If you see, Gajendra is the best example where he went into the pond and there was one crocodile by name, Kuhu. Kuhu was the crocodile, and we caught hold of the leg of this Gajendra, and they started fighting for 100 celestial years. And later on, Gajendra realized that he's finished. He doesn't have the strength to fight with this crocodile. So previous life, he was a king, and he remembered one prayer that of Vishnu. So he offered that prayer with the lotus flower, and Vishnu immediately came and he relieved him from that distress. And that is one example. That we can see those people who came to Krishna or Vishnu when they were in distress. The second is inquisitive one. The inquisitive one were the sages of Naimisharanya who came to find out about this Supreme Lord. So that's where Bhagavatam says that the second category, inquisitive one, were the sages of the Naimisharanya. And the third category, material desire, Can somebody tell from Bhagavatam who came to Krishna with the material desire?
Dhruva Maharaj, Prabhuji.
Yes, Dhruva Maharaj came with the material desire. And the last one, Jnani, the four Kumaras came with that the inquisition, that basically to seek knowledge are Jnani. So the four categories. But if you see what, so later on we'll see that what's the difference between going to Krishna versus going to the demigod. So what happens? So we'll go to the next sloka. Any questions so far? Are we good?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay. So the next sloka is the 19th one. So the next sloka is Bahunam Janmanante Gnanavan Mam Prapadyante Vasudeva Sarvamiti Sa Mahatma Sudhurlabha. This is where Ramesh Prabhu, what he was asking, we can see here. After many births and deaths, he who is actually in knowledge surrenders to me, unto me, knowing me to be the cause of all causes and all that is. Such a great soul is very rare. So, see, as Ramesh Prabhu, go ahead.
Which shloka, Prabhuji, now you have read?
719.
Okay.
Bahunam Janmanamante Gnanavan Mam Prapadyate Vasudeva Sarvamiti Sah Mahatma Sudurlabha. After many births and deaths, he who is actually in knowledge surrenders unto me. So, what is the litmus test? Malti Mataji, this is what we need to understand. If you have got the knowledge or the real knowledge, that should make you or probe you or take you to surrender. If this knowledge that you are gaining and that is going to pop up your self-ego and take you away from Krishna, but not to surrender, that is not the knowledge. The knowledge means that which will make you surrender to Krishna. That is what is the actual knowledge. That's what Krishna is saying. Knowing me to what knowledge Krishna is talking about, how can you surrender? So when you know that, knowing me to be the cause of all causes and that is all. And that is all here, meaning that he is the supreme proprietor, supreme controller, and he is everything. Sarva karana karanam. So that is what Brahma also says, right? So that is what one will realize. Okay. So that more or less... gives us to end this particular section of what is it? H stands for hearing, E stands for everywhere, and A stands for accept or reject. There are four kinds of people who accept Krishna, and there are four kinds of people who reject Krishna. That's what we discussed. And he says that the out of these four who surrender to Krishna, the best is the one who is a jnani, who is looking for or who is gained that particular knowledge, and he surrenders to me. And such great soul is very rare, he says. Why is that? You may ask, as Ramesh Prabhu was asking, why is that Krishna has made such an arrangement that it is very difficult for to come back to him? And why is that he says such a great soul is very rare? So the answer to that, see, what happens is that if you get to surrender to Krishna, what will happen is that Krishna is bound with you. That means you can control Krishna, because you have seen that in most of the cases that once you are surrendered to Krishna, and you can now dictate to Krishna to do whatever. Though you won't do it, but again, that is what will happen, that you can control Krishna. So that is the reason why Krishna also doesn't want anybody and everybody to just like that come and get all this whatever. In the sense that you should be really qualified to get that kind of an association with Krishna. because you will be able to control Krishna, who is the Supreme Lord, who is controlling the entire universes. So to go to that stage, yes, you need to make your endeavor, but it is, if you follow the process, it takes time, but you should be able to reach it with Krishna's mercy. Mm-hmm. So we end logically this section, we'll go to the next section, which is the demigod section. We'll go to the next loka, which is what the demigods. So here, 720 to 725, others who have no knowledge, those who surrender to the demigods. So those who do not have this knowledge about the Supreme Lord, they surrender to the demigods. And those who are impersonalist also, they are also the impersonalist. There are other category of people who think that Krishna has no form and he is not a person. So that's those kind of people also are there. So
here I have a doubt about impersonalist.
Go ahead.
Impersonalist is only the persons who worship Shiva. Or the impersonalist can be come under this Brahman realization and Paramatma realization. Till that realization only they call, till that realization only they called as impersonalist. Or the persons who worship Shiva can also be called as Mayavadis.
Okay, we'll discuss that, Mataji. To just to address that very quickly, impersonalists are the people who do not consider that the Supreme Lord has got a form. That's one thing you need to take it. They feel that a Krishna, I've discussed with one of the impersonalists directly. They say that from impersonal, Krishna comes. They say that the absolute truth is impersonal. That means the absolute truth has no form. From that formlessness, Krishna can take any avatars. He'll take, one is Krishna avatar. The Rama avatar, he can take any of this one. So they are also kind of following Bhagavatam in one way, understanding, but again, not with the right mindset. They think that the absolute truth is formless, Nirankar. And from that Nirankar, these Akars have come. But we are not considering that way. What we are saying is that from Akar, because there are, because as the Srila Prabhupada gives a nice example about the sun rays, planet and sun god. So the realization of the truth are at different levels. The impersonalist, whatever they are considering, that is also part of their learning. But again, they think that that is what is absolute, that is wrong. So Krishna has got an impersonal form also, because as Brahman, he is available in all these, wherever we see. But again, he has got a personal form that they do not really consider. That is where we call them as impersonalist. Got it, Mataji? More details can be dealt not only in this chapter, in the next chapter, first sloka, the eighth sloka, first sloka, Arjuna is asking, can you tell me more about the demigods and more about these kind of people is what he is going to ask. Wherein material manifestation and what are the demigods, explain in more detail, and what is self, what is Brahman, all this is what he is going to ask in the 8th chapter, first sloka. So more details can come. Okay, Mataji. So we'll go next to this particular sloka, the 20th sloka. So here in this particular sloka, those whose intelligence has been stolen by material desire surrender unto demigods and follow the particular rules and regulations of worshipping according to their own nature. So that is what he is mentioning here. Can somebody read the purport for this particular sloka?
Can I, Prabhuji?
Yeah, go ahead, Madhav.
Who are freed from all material contamination, surrender unto the Supreme Lord and engage in his devotional service. As long as the material contamination is not completely washed off, they are by nature non-devotees. But even those who have material desires and who resort to the Supreme Lord are not so much attracted by external nature because of approaching the right goal, they soon become free from all material lust. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, it is recommended that whether one is a pure devotee and is free from all material desires or is full of material desires or desires liberation from material contamination, he should in all cases surrender to Vasudeva and worship him. As stated in the Bhagavatam 2.3.10, Akama Sarva Kamova Moksha Kama Udhara Di Trivar Tivrena Bhakti Yogena Yajeta Purusham Param. Less intelligent people who have lost their spiritual sense take shelter of demigods for immediate fulfillment of material desires. Generally, such people do not go to the Supreme Personality of Godhead because they are in the lower modes of nature, ignorance and passion, and therefore worship various demigods. Following the rules and regulations of worship, they are satisfied. The worshippers of demigods are motivated by small desires and do not know how to reach the supreme goal, but a devotee of the Supreme Lord is not misguided. Because in Vedic literatures, there are recommendations for worshipping different gods for different purposes. Example, a deceased man is recommended to worship the sun. Those who are not devotees of the Lord think that for certain purposes, demigods are better than the Supreme Lord. But a pure devotee knows that the Supreme Lord Krishna is the master of all. In the Chaitanya Charitamrita Adilila 5.142, it is said, Ekale Ishwara Krishna Arasabha Vrutya. Only the Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna is master and all others are servants. Therefore, a pure devotee never goes to demigods for satisfaction of his material needs. He depends on the Supreme Lord and the pure devotee is satisfied with whatever he gives.
Okay, Mataji. Thank you. That is where we need to end. Okay. So here, if you see, now those who have lack of knowledge about Krishna, so they go to the demigods. One thing he is clearly mentioning. And the other thing he says is that whatever these people are doing, worshipping the demigods, they are doing it because it is there in the Shastras. They are going to the demigods, worshipping them in the way what is there in the Shastras, because we suppose somebody based on their modes of nature, especially those who are in passion and ignorance, those people go to these respective demigods. Because they wanted short-term goals and they wanted immediately instant gratification. So those kind of people go to these demigods. If you take Ravana and Hiranyakashipu, they have approached, either they have approached Shiva or Brahma or both. And Ravana has approached both and he has got all the benefit. But one thing I need to understand, these demigods do not really consider before giving these boons whether it will benefit the other person or not. You came to me, I have to get obliged, so I am giving it to you. That's all it is. You know that, who was that? Bhasmasura. Bhasmasura asked for a boon to Shiva, saying that whosoever I put my hand, he should just vanish. So, Shiva never thought whether this person will use it for the right reason or wrong reasons. He asked me, I give it. So that is how these demigods are there. Now, you may ask, where are these demigods getting the power? And here it is clearly mentioning that the demigods are the servants of the Supreme Lord. So they are representatives of the Supreme Lord. They are also getting the power to give it to others because that is again given by the Supreme Lord's this thing only, they are getting it. Okay. Any questions anybody has in this context? Because there will be so many, I thought. If anybody has got, we'll address them. And we'll end
this. From the marginal energy only, the demigods has risen from Krishna?
Demigods are like you and me. So the special categories are like Shiva is a special category, but other than that, you can also become Brahma one day. Indra, Chandra, all these are demigods. So one can really go there. You can also become. and these are all designations. So Brahma is a position, Indra is a position, and Chandra is a position. Today you are, we know that who is become the next Brahma also, based on the activities that they are doing. So yes, anybody can qualify. They are also like you and me. They are also living entities that you need to understand. But they did some activities such a way that they are given that responsibility to undertake. Again, they also have some material desires. If you do not have that material desires, you can also not go into that position. There are very few, and as we cannot compare with Shiva, that Shiva is a different category. But any other demigods, they also have desired that kind of a thing, so they got it. Okay.
The any goddesses also, Prabhuji, goddesses also comes under
everybody.
They're having some desires with that great karma, yes. They become goddesses.
Right. They have, unless until you, there are very few, at least the Shastra doesn't say that they are coming there because they wanted to do the service to the Supreme Lord. Because if the material world is created, we need some designated people to take up some services. So at least the Shastra is not saying that these demigods have come with the interest to serve the Supreme Lord. So if they have the interest to serve the Supreme Lord, they would generally be asked to be in Goloka and they could serve. But since they have their desire, so they have come. So that's what Shastra is saying. Any other question before we end? Okay. So the next 21st sloka also is very important. Let me read that translation. I am in everyone's heart as the super soul. As soon as one desires to worship some demigod, I make his faith steady so that he can devote himself to that particular deity. So this is a very important sloka in the sense what it says is that I am in everyone's heart as the super soul. As soon as one desires to worship some demigod, I make his faith steady so that he can devote himself to that particular deity. What does that mean here? Anybody, what is your understanding? Your voice is breaking, Mataji.
Prabhuji, one.
Your voice is breaking. Go ahead, anybody. My voice was breaking or hello?
Prabhuji, actually one who was like a favorite demigod, so he gave faith to do this devotion to the demigod. Is that so?
Yeah, so basically what it is said here, can somebody read the purport first para?
God has given independence to everyone. Therefore, if a person desires to have material enjoyment and wants very sincerely to have such facility from the material demigods, the Supreme Lord, as a super soul in everyone's heart, understands and gives facility to such persons. You want me to continue, Prabhuji?
Yes, Prabhu, entire para.
As the supreme father of all living entities, he does not interfere with their independence, but gives all facilities so that they can fulfill their material desires. Some may ask why the all-powerful God gives facility to the living entities for enjoying this material world, and so lets them fall into the trap of the illusory energy. The answer is that if the Supreme Lord as a super soul does not give such facilities, then there is no meaning to independence. Therefore, he gives everyone full independence, whatever one likes. But his ultimate instruction we find in the Bhagavad Gita, one should give up all other engagements and fully surrender unto him. That will make a man happy.
Okay, thank you, Prabhu. So, see, what Krishna is saying is that this faith, whatever, see, if you wanted to if you wanted to get engaged with some demigod or worship the demigod, you need to have faith. And that faith is what Krishna is saying, I give that faith such that you can get attached to this demigod. See, ultimately, when you get attached to this demigod, slowly this faith can, so after a certain time, it can result in saying for you to become a devotee also. Because, see, what Shankaracharya, when Shankaracharya came, he was a Mayavadi. And for his philosophy, if not anything, what it has brought in is that it has built faith in the faith in these devotees. And that faith at least will give rise to surrendering to Krishna at later point. So that is what we need to understand. Can you mute, Prabhu? Okay. So,
sorry, bro.
No issues, bro. It's been a long time that we heard from Arjun. So, so we are kind of okay. Malti Mata, do you have a question or anything, or any other devotee? So we can conclude this. Who are the people who approach the demigod? And we clearly it is mentioned that those who are interested to get material gains, they approach because their power is to give only material level boons only. They cannot go beyond that. And their capacity is there, they'll give it. And whether it is going to make you a devotee or not, they don't care. But there are some exceptions. We'll discuss that. But any other question?
So Prabhuji, according to their will, freedom and intelligence of a person, Krishna give that power to attach to the demigods.
He gives you the faith. He gives you because, see, end of the day, understand one thing. We have the free will, we have the independence. Unless and until the Paramatma who is there in our heart, he does not sanction you, nothing will happen. We know that.
Yes.
So that Paramatma sanctioning you, with what? He's giving you that faith. And that faith is what Krishna is giving, not based on your this thing. That faith also is Krishna. Understand one thing, we are nothing. We are like Katputli in one way, but again, that free intelligence, independence is there. We need to utilize it. But to utilize that independence also, his involvement is required. And that is what is there as a Paramatma. Sanctioner to make that whatever. So that's what he's doing. So any other questions? We'll wind up. Okay. No other question? Ramesh Prabhu, you're good? Okay. So the next question is that, Ramesh Prabhu, you have a question? Yeah, the last question with you and then we'll wind up. Yeah, you raised your hand, Ramesh.
No, by mistake. I'm very sorry.
Okay, no problem. So now you may ask a question saying that were there any devotees or anybody who has worshipped these demigods and got in touch with Krishna? Because there are there any examples that are there in our Shastra? And in the Shastra, there are few devotees, few of the who have gone to Krishna by approaching the demigods. And one is from Vallabhacharya. So Vallabhacharya was a devotee of Shiva. And but he didn't have any material desire. And he was a devotee of Shiva, so he went there. And when Shiva appeared, he asked, "What do you want?" Then he said, "Give me something where you hold very, valuable." So he asked Shiva, "Give me something which you hold very valuable." Then Shiva then gave the Krishna consciousness. Or he has given some impetus for him to go to Krishna. So then he became a great Acharya, Vallabhacharya, became a great Acharya, and he became a Krishna Bhakta. So this is one where you went to, somebody went to Krishna, a demigod, and he became a Krishna Bhakta. But he went without any material desire. But then when, and he also used his free will to ask this, and then he was pointed to Krishna. Then there are second instance is the Chandidas. Chandidas was actually a Durga worshipper, the Kali Durga worshipper. The Chandi also means Durga. We know that, right? And how he became a devotee of Krishna is basically he was worshipping the Durga and for so many years by flowers as a, and all that. One day what happens is that his brother was a Vaishnava Bhakta. And this person Chandidas didn't have flowers to offer it to Durga. So he sees that his brother has already plucked the flowers and it is ready. And his brother has mentally offered it to Vishnu and he kept it there. But he didn't know, he picked up those flowers and offered it to the Kali. Kali Devi he has offered, and actually Kali Devi comes outside from that deity and he appears in front of the Chandidas. And she asks, and basically Chandidas asks, I've been worshipping for so many years. How is that you have appeared in front of me now only? She says that I'm very happy because you have offered me Mahaprasad. And how did I offer this Mahaprasad? Then he realizes that his brother has offered these flowers to Vishnu mentally. So now it, when it is offered to her, she is very happy. And that basically makes him, gets the right kind of a knowledge to approach Krishna, and he becomes a Krishna Bhakta. One last is about Keshav Kashmiri. We know that Keshav Kashmiri was a very renowned, Pandit who had good knowledge about Shastra. And he was worshipper of Saraswati Devi. And because of his knowledge, etc. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu brings that knowledge to him such that he understands about Krishna. Though he was worshipper of Saraswati Devi, he turns out to be a Krishna Bhakta at a later point of time. Not just he, but his lot of followers. The Shastra says that around 50,000-60,000 of his followers also get converted into Krishna Bhaktas. So that is what I have to say. And this logic.
Prabhuji, I have a doubt, Prabhuji.
Go ahead, Mataji.
Prabhuji, in Vrindavan, the before the Govardhan Leela, the Vrajvasis worship Indra. How can we see this? According to this concept, Prabhuji.
So they were worshipping the demigods, and but again Krishna's indirectly says that you are not supposed to worship the demigods. So and they get converted to see that's all Leela, and at the same time the pastimes where they were also worshipping the demigods. Yeah, no doubt. And when they are worshipping the Indra, then Krishna says that no, you should not worship the Indra, you should worship Govardhan. And Govardhan is none other than Krishna himself. So that way he has convinced them. And see, in Vrindavan, whatever Krishna says, all Brajavasis will listen. So that way he has made that arrangement. That's what I know, Mataji. Mm-hmm. So any other questions, anything anybody has? So the last section, last few slokas of especially the 29th verse, basically Krishna here mentions about Yoga Mishra Bhakta. So not pure devotees, Yoga Mishra Bhakta, those who have material desires, but still they consider that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. So those are called Yoga Mishra Bhaktas, because till now we have considered the devotees who are black and white. Now here, these are the Yoga Mishra Bhaktas, are the people, are devotees who have material desire, but also consider Krishna as the Supreme Lord. So that is what here it is mentioned. And their desire for liberation, and they know that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They are looking for liberation, and they are looking for liberation from the Janma Mrityu Jara Vyadi. But their destination may not be Goloka, but they just wanted to come out of this misery. What are the four miseries? Janma Mrityu Jara Vyadi. But again, they know that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. These are called Yoga Mishra Bhaktas. That's what Krishna is saying in the 29th sloka. And the next sloka, Krishna is going to talk more about that in greater details, which will help us to understand more knowledge about the Supreme, is what, and especially the demigods, who are these demigods, more details can be discussed in the next chapter, attaining the Supreme. So, in a nutshell, what we all discussed is that to the knowledge of the Absolute can be attained, which starting with hearing about the Supreme Lord, and we need to understand that everywhere Krishna is present, and if you wanted to remember Krishna, you can remember Krishna by seeing the everywhere. In the water he is there, in the sun as light he is there, in the moon he is there, in the fragrance of the flower he is there, everywhere he is there. So you can remember Krishna if you know this. And there are four types of people who reject or who do not want to surrender to Krishna, and the four types of people who surrender to Krishna. And in addition to that, there is one more category called Yoga Mishra Bhaktas, who are also there, who consider Krishna as the Supreme Lord, but again, they wanted to get liberated from this Janma Mrityu Jara Vyadi. So that is also one category of people are there. And the demigod worshippers, we have seen, these demigod worshippers are the people who wanted immediate relief from their problem. So they kind of approach them. But again, this immediate relief is for their material desires only, or material wants, because that is what they can fulfill. And he does that. And in very few occasions, those who have approached the demigods have also given a route where they can approach Krishna also. Though they came to them, they have diverted them to take up Krishna consciousness. So that ends this chapter. So if no other question, then we can end. Hare Krishna. Venkat Prabhu, go ahead. You have a question?
Yeah, Prabhuji. So when we say we should not worship demigods, so I just have a general mundane question. So now Shivratri is coming and we have Vinayak Chaturthi and all that. So we should stop observing those festivals or...
Very nice question, Prabhu. Wonderful. So basically, see, one thing you need to take in, if you can celebrate, but if you connect it with Krishna. See, if you take Shiva is the one of the pious Vaishnavas, or he is the highest among the Vaishnavas. So he is the purest devotee. So that way you can respect him, and you can consider him as the Vaishnava. That way we can do. But giving the position of the Supreme Lord, Krishna's position, to Shiva is not as per the Shastra. One should not do. So celebrating can be done, but not compromising on the aspects of what, who is what. You give him the right kind of platform, and you can do that. And in some of the ISKCON temples, when I was in Seattle, we also celebrated Shivratri. But again, remembering Krishna and remembering Shiva as a pure devotee of Krishna. So that way you can do. And similarly, Vinayak Chauthi. Ganesha festival, you can, but again understand that who, when we approach these demigods, you are going with some kind of a desire. You are saying that you are celebrating Vinayak Chauthi. Most of the people do that because they do not want any vignas in their whatever endeavor that they are there. But most of the time it is of we are going to these demigods because we do not want any hindrances or obstacles in our material endeavor, not for spiritual endeavor. So if you can approach them, if you want, they are pure but devotees in one way, so you can approach them, but not with any material desire. And as we said, this particular you have seen Vallabhacharya has went to Shiva because he was attracted towards Shiva, and but again he didn't have any material desire, and he asked for something which is what he holds very valuable, and he gave it to, he has given Krishna bhakti, or he has diverted him to go to Krishna. So that's all it is. So any other
question? It's like if we celebrate and take their blessings in elevating Krishna consciousness, that we can do it, Prabhuji?
Can you reiterate the question one more time?
Like, see, Prabhuji, like I am doing a Shivratri for Shiva. In return, if I take the blessings to elevate me in Krishna consciousness, that can happen, Prabhuji? Not the material desire.
Right. That is fine, Prabhu. But point what I am saying, or what is said here, is that whatever you want, which you are going to get from the Supreme, from the demigods, you can go and approach the Krishna himself. Why are you taking a deer tour? Suppose, as it is mentioned here, suppose you are inquisitive. You need some wealth. You need something else. Approach Krishna, no. So when you approach Krishna, one danger is there. What is that danger? Can somebody tell me? One danger or one caveat?
He will give what we deserve, not we desire.
Not only he gives you what you deserve, he will give you what is best for you. And see, so suppose you go and approach him for giving you a lot of wealth. And Dhruva went right. Let's take the Dhruva's example. Dhruva went for what? He said, I wanted a kingdom, I wanted a wealth which is bigger than his grandfather, Brahma. Not even his father, grandfather's bigger than his grandfather, Brahma. So much he wanted. Then did Krishna give it or not?
Yes, he did.
He did give, but in turn, what he also did is that Krishna, that material desire, whatever is there, he just removed that material desire also. And then he gave, but again, he gave without any attachment, because it is not good for you to have this material attachment. So he removed that and he gave. So what is best for you? It is, again, a mundane example I'll tell. Suppose you go to you are interested to eat some chocolates, a lot of chocolates. You have some money and you go to a shopkeeper and you ask him, can you give me some chocolates? This is the money. Will he give or not?
Yes, of course, Prabhu.
He will give. So this is how a demigod is. Demigod doesn't really bother about whether it will be good for you, whether you will be utilizing it properly, whether your health will spoil. They don't care. Because why they don't do it? Because there is no attachment with you and the demigod. This might be a risky proposition that I am putting, but this is the fact that is given in this particular chapter only. I did not discuss it in greater detail, but in one of the slokas it is given that what will happen is that you are a living entity and the demigods are also living entities. They also have soul and Paramatma, and you also have soul and Paramatma. And now the natural attraction for you is not between a living entity and a living entity. Your natural attraction is an attraction between you and the Supreme Lord Krishna. That is your eternal connection, not that you have an eternal connection with the demigod.
So there is no loving affection between the demigod and you. Understand this. Now you take any demigod for that matter. No, there is not a single living entity which has proved in the entire history that they have a loving relationship as you have it between you and the Supreme Lord. Can you show me one example? In Bhagavatam or in any of these, you will not find. Because you do not have that relationship between living entity to living entity. You have the relationship between yourself and the Supreme Lord. That's your eternal relationship. That is where you are launching for. So why you go for this via route and do all this? Approach Krishna and do whatever. Don't fear and don't see what will happen if I go to Krishna and ask for some desires that I have. If he is my Supreme Father, and as a storekeeper, he doesn't really care about whether this chocolate will help me or not. But when I go to my father and say that these are the chocolates I wanted to buy, he will first tell you that, hey, this is not really good for you. Only if at all you wanted to take, I will tell you that this is the brand you need to take. Or you take only one small quantity. And that's how he will counsel you, because you have a natural affection of a child and a father relationship. But the storekeeper doesn't have that relationship. He'll just do his duty. And all the demigods are doing their duty, because that's what they are meant for. Hope I made that clear, Prabhu.
Prabhuji, I just want to add one point regarding this demigod worship for tomorrow's festival and all. So, practically, Prabhuji, initially, at this platform, I cannot stop worshipping or doing these festivals of demigods, but with the devotee association, what I've done is like first, for example, for tomorrow's or day after tomorrow or whatever festival is coming, that prasada we can offer first to Krishna, then we can do that festival, because we have some traditions who are our in-laws or parents are following, we cannot stop. But with the advice of one of the pure devotees which I have association previously, that Mataji told me, not to stop initially, so that first we offer this to Krishna, keeping his deities above level or the frame of the picture, then below that we can worship whatever festivals. But later, after coming to a point of knowledge, we can undoubtedly, 100% we can stop worshipping demigods, Prabhuji. That's what I did.
Yes,
we
have completely stopped demigod worship. That's the right approach, no doubt about it. And at any point of time, we are not supposed to disrespect any of the demigods. They are representatives of Supreme Lord Krishna. So we cannot disrespect them. So that one thing we should understand. If you worship, ideally you can go. Worshipping is secondary. First of all, don't disrespect them. That's what we need to understand. And if you see, as you said, the example, Chandidas. When was the Durga Mata very happy? When she got the Mahaprasad, the flowers that were offered to Vishnu, when it was offered to her, she was very happy. So this is one of the classical cases, right? So that way, they will not get offended when they get Mahaprasad offered to Krishna and you offer it to them. That's also good. And if you have some problem in your home by offering it to Krishna and then offering it to her, because there might be some situations where they might not understand this. So mentally offer it to Krishna and then offer it to her or him, whosoever is the demigod. But just to keep things normal, to balance things. That's what one can do. Make sense, Prabhuji's, Mataji's? Can we end here today?
Even Shiva also will be jumping Krishna's only, Krishna God only.
Mataji, repeat that one more time.
Even Shiva God will be jumping only Krishna's name only. I've heard in Bhagavatam in some story. Shiva will be reciting the Bhagavatam to Parvati Devi.
Yeah, yeah.
So even the Sukha Maharaj will be listening when he was in a parrot.
Absolutely, Mata.
So you can think that even Shiva is the devotion of Krishna.
you know that, right? The pastime where Narada gets a little bit of Mahaprasad of Vishnu, remnants of the Vishnu. And that little bit he gives, and he was so happy, jubilantly jumping here and there just because he got the Mahaprasad of Vishnu. And when he goes to Shiva, and Shiva inquires, and he says that this is the because I got Mahaprasad of Vishnu. And he says that, why don't you give little bit to me? And he takes it, and he is also jumping like anything. Then Parvati asks, how is that? So all that we'll discuss some other time. But see, all the demigods, they are also, to get that position, they might have endeavored so much. And they are also happy when you are taking Krishna consciousness. And they, as Prabhupada in the classical way, he says that when you want to water a tree, you wanted to put the water to the roots such that the branches, fruits, the leaves, everything gets nourished. Similarly, when you give or you worship the Supreme Lord Shri Krishna, all the demigods, all the millions of demigods whosoever are there, everybody will be happy and they will be pleased with you. So no doubt about it. So don't think that if earlier I was doing Ganesh Chauti for about 20 years, now how I can all of a sudden stop? Lord Ganesha will get offended. No, they will not get offended, because it is there as per the Shastra, and Srila Prabhupada clearly mentions that if Krishna is satisfied, if you worship to Krishna, you are already taken care of satisfying all the demigods. So no doubt about it. Be clear from your head that you are not disrespecting any of them, and you are doing the right thing. And when you are doing praying for Krishna, you are taking his mercy, and these demigods are also very happy with you. And they will also bestow such that you will be able to continue your Krishna Bhakti. Okay, so we'll end here today. I'm sorry that I couldn't really stop of doing this food for the soul, what Usha Mataji and Malati Mataji were supposed to do. So please do take up tomorrow. Continue the same timetable. And if time permits, we will club sometime, or we'll see how we can do. We'll continue till Friday, and the next one can be postponed for presentation one to the next class. Okay, so we will do Kirtan for a few minutes. Ravi Prabhu, we're very happy to see you after a long time. Hare Krishna. So you are the same Ravi Prabhu or some other Ravi Prabhu?
Thank you so much, Prabhuji.
What? Thank you, Prabhu. You are not responding these days at all. So thank you for joining, Prabhu. We are very happy to see you. And please do continue to come.
Very much grateful to you, Prabhuji.
Thank you, Prabhu. Okay, we'll do Kirtan for a few minutes, and then we will take leave today.
Prabhuji, I thank the ISKCON Hyderabad that I received Mahaprasadam today, Prabhuji.
Oh, wow. Very nice. Thank you, Mataji, for sharing that. And those who have given your addresses, if you are not able to get the prasadam, please contact Sanda, and she will be able to contact them and find out. But mostly you should be getting all your prasadam in a couple of days probably. All those who are out of station also, we have sent the prasadam. Okay. Thank you, Malati Mataji. You are in Kakinada, Mataji? You are in Kakinada now or some other place?
No, Prabhuji, I came to Vizag, but I received prasadam in Kakinada. It's with my parents. I couldn't have it, but still they are having that
prasadam. That's good. Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Dhanvat Pranam.
Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Usha Mataji, can you follow after me?
Yes, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna
Govinda.
Krishna Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna Mahamantra ki jai, Anant Koti Vaishnava Vrinda ki jai, Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Thank you, Mataji, Usha Mataji. Thank you very much. And all the devotees who have assembled.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Please forgive me for the delay. And we all,
Prabhuji, I want to wish all the Mataji's the happy Mataji's Day.
Oh.
Happy Mataji's Day.
Happy Mataji's Day.
Thank you, Mataji.
I also wish, I wish all the Mataji's what do they call it as? Women's Day.
Happy Women's Day.
Happy Women's Day.
So I wish that this Women's Day would make you a pure devotee of Krishna, because we need to dovetail everything for Krishna. So you kind of surrender yourself to Krishna's lotus feet and do your activities. That way I would like to pray. Thank you very much, Matajis, Prabhujis, for your presence today. And see you all tomorrow in the morning, Mangalarati. The food for group's chapa session, and in the evening tomorrow, the food for soul session. The timetable will remain the same. It will continue. We'll just shift it to the next day. Today's activity will be tomorrow. That's all. Thank you very much again. Any questions, Hare anything?
Prabhuji, please, for beautiful me. Session today.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Dandavat.
Hare Krishna, brother.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. Govardhan Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Dandavat Pranam.